Noah's Ark exhibit. Has anybody seen that? It's wonderful. Just an amazing in size. You just really can't comprehend how large this thing is until you stand next to it. Here's a picture of my crazy family at the edge of it. So it's this full-scale replica. It's amazing. But you can see the size of us, how it is, but you can really tell. But look at these people over here, how large this thing is. It is huge. It is worth your trip to go up there to see and to enjoy how it might have worked, you know, how they might have cared for all those animals. Very, very fascinating. A lot of walking, but really, really, really big. No wonder it took 100 years to build it, right? But anyway, it was an amazing trip, worth the drive. I highly recommend it. Really interesting. And well, before we went to this, we stayed and I got a VRBO that was a farmhouse, and it was on 100 acres of farmland. I could have stayed there the whole time. It was absolutely gorgeous, but it was very rural, right? So beautiful land, just wonderful. And so we picked it because it was out of the way and we could enjoy that as well, not stay in hotels. So anyway, we weren't familiar, obviously, with the rural land of Kentucky, except we did learn why it's called the Rolling Hills of Kentucky. It goes up and down and up and down. Anyway, so we were on our way to the Ark, and so we decided, well, we'll just do what everybody else does, right? Follow your GPS, right? So we decided, I mean, like, how hard can it be to find where you're going? It's the job of those map people to tell us where we wanted to be and how to get there. So what we found out, though, was in these rural areas of Kentucky that the maps were not exactly accurate with the latest information. So we took a route that they told us to take, and we ended up there. It's like, you know, road closed, bridge out, you know, grass growing in the thing. So this is not a new thing. This has been like this a long time, but, you know, every time that we tried to go, okay, well, you know, we just had to turn around and just kind of go until we found this another route. So this story about our road trip is going to come back around it later on in the lesson, but it kind of is a good illustration of what we find in the back half of Galatians. So I want to take just a minute to bring you up to speed where you are. This is, you have been here the whole time. I'm just going to give you a jet view over the top of where we've been. And because what we get to in Galatians chapter 3 is important, and Paul is just weaving this whole argument throughout the whole letter, addressing really one issue. And so in the first part of the book, we discover that there's a problem in the Galatians church. And the believers there were being pressed by the Jewish Christians in the area and the Jewish teachers, and what they were being pressed to do is mix a little bit of the law in with faith in Christ. And so, yes, they were saying Christ is, of course, important, but also you need to keep doing everything that all those rules and regulations that were written in the law of Moses. And so Paul jumped in, and really in the strongest language, as you'll see in any of his letters, he basically says to them, whoa, stop, is what he said. What are you guys doing? And he says, you know, why are you listening to what these legalistic guys are telling you about faith in Christ? And so he's like, have you forgotten what I've taught you? And so that's really what the whole issue around the Galatians letter is. And so he gives them this reminder as we kind of move through chapter 1, that he says, I preached the gospel to you. And he says, and what I told you didn't come from Jerusalem. It didn't come from any man, any teacher. What I got was from Christ himself. And that's what I told you. And you remember Sandy told us all about that way back at the beginning of the lesson. And then he gives us all of these credentials that he has about himself and how he came to Christ in chapter 1. And he goes on to say that he spoke to the apostles in Jerusalem, and when he talked with them, they verified that, yes, he is preaching the gospel and that his calling is to the Gentiles and to bring the gospel to those outside of the Jewish faith. And it's almost like they gathered together there in Jerusalem and they pulled out a map and they said, okay, and they got all the apostles around and they said, we'll take Jerusalem. Paul So he was like, you're totally fine with that. And Paul, when he was out in Antioch, he eventually had this clash with Peter. Because Peter knew the gospel. Remember, Peter's the apostle who says, you're Christ, the Son of the living God. He's the one in the gospels who first identified and said, yeah, you're not just a teacher. You are God sent from heaven. So Peter knew this, but he kind of had been influenced by some of these Jewish leaders and Jewish teachers to kind of start embracing the law again. And so, now remember that we kind of look back and go, why would he even do that? He was with Christ. Why would he go back to the law? But we have to remember, when we look back as believers in the 21st century, we have no idea how integrated the law was into their everyday life. It was about how they ate and where they went and what they dressed and how they related to each other. It was everything. Boundary markers, houses, everything was integrated with the law. So it was hard for them when they came to faith in Christ for somebody to say, yeah, you don't have to do that anymore. It was fulfilled in Christ. So they really struggled with really extracting this out of their way of thinking. And if you remember, even for Paul, who called himself in another letter the Pharisee of Pharisees. So he was steeped in all of this as well when he came to faith. And so it took some time for this to be pulled out of the way he thought. I mean, he didn't just see Christ on the Damascus Road, get up, get his sight back 3 days later, and then start preaching. In fact, the Bible says that he went away for 3 years. He didn't even talk to Peter or any of the apostles. For 3 years, he went away just to study and to be with Christ. And Christ, nobody was teaching him. Christ himself was teaching him. I'm the fulfillment. I am all that there is, and I fulfill the law. And so all of this teaching, and even it says in chapter 2 here in the book of Galatians, it was 14 years later before this incident happened. So now we're talking a decade and a half of retraining that Paul had in order to be firm in the fact that you are saved by grace through faith. And so we can understand how difficult this was, but by the time he gets to Peter, by the time he has his interaction with Peter, Paul's clear. He understands what he's saying. And he couldn't let this just pass by because what they were teaching was not benign. They were not just saying, yeah, it's fine, if you want to keep the law, you can keep the law, it's fine. They were saying it's required for you to keep the law. It's required for you to be circumcised. It's required for you to be, following all these rules of Moses. And so he's saying that you can't blend the law and faith because it undermines everything that Christ came for. So this is a serious issue. So this week's portion of chapter 2 is kind of a continuation of that argument. He's weaving one argument all the way through Galatians chapter 3. So I'm going to back up and just going to hit really quickly the other arguments that we saw last week. And because what he's saying is trying to observe the law as a means of justification is a bad idea. It is bad doctrine. It is an opposite of what Christ teaches. So he starts with verse at the beginning. He says the law does not lead to justification, and he appeals to personal experience first. That's what you see in chapter 2 we saw last week. Galatians 3:2 says, I would like to learn just one thing from you. So he's asking him, he's like, did you receive the Spirit by observing the law or by believing what you heard, that is heard from me? And so this is a rhetorical question that he's asking them. These Christians in the Galatian church were by and large not Jews. They were not from a Jewish background. Some of them, no doubt, had no idea who Moses was, what the Sabbath was, what any of the thousands of years of history, of Jewish history and the history of Israel were. They just didn't know. They came from a completely pagan or Gentile background. So the only way they would know what the Jewish laws were was bits and pieces they might pick up from interacting with other Jews. Like, say, if they visited Jerusalem, they might have seen the temple, or they might have interacted with other Jewish people in the community, saw how they dressed, heard what they said, but they don't have any experience. It's not their, from their background. And so their belief did not come. They did not come to be Christians through the preaching of the law. When Paul showed up to talk to them, he didn't say, let me tell you all about the law, and then I'll tell you about Christ. He just started with Christ. Christ, who he was, he was crucified, was resurrected, and he was interceding for them on behalf on their behalf at the right hand of the Father. So then he just told them the truth of the gospel, and that this was given to them, like we saw in the first two chapters, by revelations from Christ himself. So he appealed first to their personal experience. Then he said, the second argument he makes is that the covenant promise to Abraham comes through faith, not the law. And he goes on to say that the law doesn't give them access to the covenant of God, to the covenant that God gave to Abraham. So he's going to say it again. He goes on to say that the law doesn't give them access to the covenant of Abraham. In fact, these Gentile believers would actually have been excluded from the promise that God gave to Abraham because they were not Abraham's offspring. They were not descendants of Abraham. So they would actually be excluded from the promise that they had that had been given to Abraham on behalf of the Jews. But through faith in Christ, they are brought under this covenant, is what Paul is saying here. And the covenant really foreshadowed, this covenant of Abraham foreshadowed the truth that by faith, everyone is included an inheritor and becomes inheritors of the covenant promise of God. That's what verses 7 through 9 says. Look at verse 8. The scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. And so he's saying that this wasn't just specific to the Jews, that this proclamation included the Gentiles all the way from the beginning. Verse 9, so those who have faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. And then the third argument he makes is, looking to the law as a means of obtaining righteousness is flawed from the very beginning. Verse 10, all who rely on observing the law are under a curse, for it is written, curses everyone who does not continue to do, key word here, everything written in the book of the law. So last week I was sitting in a group last week, and somebody in the group said, I wonder how many laws and rules and regulations are in the first five books of the Bible. So I looked it up. There are 613 separate rules that they were required to keep by the law. And I remember what Sandy said last week, just like kind of stuck with me. How could they even remember them, let alone keep them? I mean, imagine that your to-do list has 600 items on it. Not 600 items to be accomplished in a year, or in 6 months, or 1 month, but 600 items on your to-do list every single day. Mm. That's overwhelming just to even think about, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, and so you think, okay, well, maybe we could just summarize. Well, that's what the Ten Commandments are, right? God's top 10 list, that's a summary of the whole of the law. But how you doing with that? Not really good, right? So let's go just take it down to one, right? Let's take the first one, Exodus 20, verse 3. You shall not have no other gods before me. So, how many of you at any time of your life have ever loved something or been more devoted to something than God? Oh, yeah. Yeah, everybody, right? It's like, so we can't even keep one. We can't keep one. So Paul is basically saying to them, going back to the law to try to obtain righteousness before God, right standing before God, is a crazy idea. Why would you do that? When you've been freed by Christ, why would you go back today. And that brings us also to point number four, which is the covenant promise to Abraham was made before the law was handed down. So the covenant that God gave to Abraham was in effect before the law was given. So what this is based on, so let's walk through this. We'll get to this idea in just a second. But verse 15 says, brothers, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. So basically what this is saying here is that once a covenant is established, the parameters of the covenant can't be changed, right? Y'all understand that. Can't be added to, can't be taken away from. Once the covenant is in place, you can't change it. It's like, say, you were going to sell your house, right? And so somebody came and said, I'll buy your house for this amount of money, but I want you to change, I need a new water heater, and I need you to change carpet. Okay? And you go, okay, we can do that. For this price, we'll do that. And then you sit down with your lawyers and your real estate agent, they drop the contract, and you sign it, and they sign it. Now, they can't come back to you after it's been signed to say, yeah, you know what, we want an air conditioner too. And you're like, we're not doing that. You get the water heater and the carpet. That's it. It's like, because you agreed to this, right? By the same token, you can't go to them and say, yeah, well, we think the carpet downstairs can be replaced, but the upstairs carpet's fine, we're just going to leave it. And they'll be like, yeah, no, I want carpet throughout, right? So the parameters of the contract, the contract can come in a little different, but this kind of gives you the idea. The parameters, once they're set and it's put in and enacted, you can't change it. So that's what he's kind of saying here. So it goes on to verse 16, and he says, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. The scripture does not say into his seed, meaning many people, but into your seed, meaning one person, who is Christ. So Paul points out that the covenant promise is talking to and enacted with one seed, not just generally everybody who's the descendant of Abraham, but one seed, meaning Christ. And so just going, wait, I'm getting lost. Paul realizes that, and he says, what I mean is this. So he's going to clear it up for you. The law introduced 430 years later, which is the time between Abraham and Moses, does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance, that is what you receive as an heir of Abraham, depends on the law, then it no longer depends on a promise, but God in his grace gave it to Abraham through the promise. Okay, so what he's saying here is that Paul points out that if the promise that was given to Abraham, which is all nations will be blessed through you, required us and required them to keep the law, then it isn't a promise anymore. It's this two-sided contract. It's not a promise given by God saying, I'm going to do this for you. It's more of a bargaining thing going on. So it's based on us keeping up our side of the law, so our side of the rules, right? It's like, so if you're saying it's based on law and our ability to keep it, then what you're saying is that it's conditional. As long as you do your part, then you can have that. But when you fall down, then you can't have it. That's not what it was. Because the promise made to Abraham back in Genesis wasn't dependent on him keeping anything to receive what was offered. In fact, if you make a note on your stuff, go back and read Genesis chapter 15 sometime about the covenant that God made with Abraham. And you'll see there that Abraham wasn't really even invited to the ceremony that established the covenant. Just one verse from there says this. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. So it's like God said, go to sleep. We're going to set the contract in motion. And then you got this whole thing about the smoking pot and the burning torch and some animal sacrifices. And all that just means, it goes to say that God is telling Abraham that what's going to happen in the future, and way, way, way in the future, and he's telling him, he's like, look, this is going to happen, covenant. I'm making a covenant with you. Within the Trinity itself, we're covenanting together. You're over there asleep. You're not even involved. It's almost like he said, you are out of the equation on this. I'm making a promise within the Trinity and bestowing it on you. It is yours. Give it to you by God himself. That's what it's saying there. I'm not giving it to you based on anything other than your faith that we talked about last week. So you go back into Galatians chapter 18. I'm sorry, 3 verse 18 in the NASB, because what I'm reading from is NIV. For if the inheritance is based on the law, it is no longer based on a promise. But God has granted, that's the word I'm getting at there, it to Abraham by means of a promise. And that word granted is kacheristai. And if you see that C-H-A-R-I-S, that's the Greek word for grace. So what we're seeing there in the word that he's using there is that he has granted this to Abraham based on his grace, not on what Abraham was able to do. And so so that's that argument. The last argument he says that the law doesn't lead to justification is that the law and the promise are completely different in purpose. Completely different. So follow along here. Start with verse 19. What then was the purpose of the law, he asks? It was added because of transgressions until the seed, that is Christ, to whom the promise referred, had come. And so what it means by there that added because of transgressions is that the law clearly established God's holy standard. That's what it was telling us. Because without it, we don't know what's right and wrong, right? So if you don't have a law or a rule that tells you not to do this, you don't know if it's right or wrong or not. So in the detailed nature of this law helps us see that there is no way that we can achieve God's holy standard on our own. We can't. We talked about 613 rules. You can't do that. You just can't. And so what the law does is it pushes us and pushes us. And the more you try, the more futile your attempts are, the more you work at it, the more frustrated you get, until finally we go, I can't do this anymore. And that's the point of the law. And he said, and that's it. And God says, finally, you are saying that you're not able. And that's the point of the law, that he says, but the promised blessing that he talks to here, that is the seed, Christ, and our faith in him, that's how we receive the blessing, through faith. When we're looking back, God promised that he would do it, and looking back at what Christ did on the cross, he did do it. He fulfilled all the law on behalf of all who believe. You don't have to do it anymore because he already did. So, he goes on to the end of verse 19. Says, the law was put into effect through angels by a mediator. A mediator, however, does not represent one party, but God is one. I was reading through this week. I was like, I can't wait until Sandy tells us what that means, because I don't have any idea what that means. And I was like, oh, okay. I'm going to tell what it means. So I had to study all day today to figure out what this means. But really what I found is pretty simple. Actually, this part here refers to the fact that the law was enacted by delivering those tablets and those rules to Moses on Mount Sinai. And according to this, the way he received it is, remember this is inspired, that they were given to him by angels. So the angels delivered the law from God to Moses. They were the mediator for Moses. Moses then in turn became the mediator for the people to God. Okay, so that's the mediator part. And so when we talk about the law, he had to be kind of the go-between for them. So the law, Paul tells us, needs a middleman. It needs somebody in there because it's by nature two-sided. You do this, that happens. You don't do this, this happens. So there's two sides, and it has to be mediated. It's like that house contract that we were talking about a little bit earlier. this contract, or this, and that's what happened with the law. But the promise is different from the law. You know, it was made by God the Father in conjunction with God the Son on behalf of Abraham and his descendants. And so the promise took place and was formed within the Trinity, and because Christ is God, you didn't need any go-betweens. I mean, who's going to be a mediator for God, right? I mean, it's just him. And that's what that means at the end. God is one. There aren't two sides. They did it within themselves for us. So verse 21 goes on to say, he's asking this question, is the law therefore opposed to the promises of God? This is the question that would be in the mind of his readers. And so you're saying, is faith and the law, are they rivals? Are they opposite of each other? And he says, no, absolutely not. For if a law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. And it goes on, verse 22, it says, but the scripture declares that the whole world is a prisoner of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe. And so what he's saying here, and what we need to learn from this part, is that faith and the law have different goals. Faith leads to life. Faith is always, your faith in Christ is leading to righteousness, holiness, life, freedom, all of those things. The law has a different goal. It's going to lead you to a different place. So verse 23. Before this faith came, we were held prisoners by the law, locked up until faith should be revealed. And so faith leads to life. The law leads to prison every time. The law in every way condemns us to prison, the prison of sin. It does not and never has led people to life and freedom. That is not the purpose of the law. That's why you can't ever reach life by keeping the rules, by trying to work hard enough for God to accept you, because it's impossible. It's impossible for that to happen. The rules are there to remind you of how short you come, and for you to say, I can't do it anymore. You have to do it for me. That's the point, and it will always lead to prison. But when we try to use the law to get to life and get to freedom, it's like us grabbing hold the bars of a jail and talking to the bars saying, can you just give me freedom? Can you say, if you could just free me, talking to the bars. But the bars are what's holding us back. And so it doesn't make any sense, because it's never going to lead you to anywhere that looks like life. And so we remain locked up behind the bars of sin until we believe in Christ, and Christ sets us free. Verse 24. So the law was put in charge to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. That's exactly what it says there. Now faith has come. We are no longer under the supervision of the law. And he's telling the Galatian Christians and us, faith has made you free. Why would you try to keep the rules again? You can't make yourself better off than where you already stand, free in Christ. It's just going to lead you right back to prison again if you start trying to add law back in to faith. And that was the point of my story, the beginning, about our trip to Kentucky. We're on the wrong road. It wasn't the right road. It was never going to get us where we wanted to go. And as long as we followed the rules that were given to us by Google Maps, we were going to end up right back at that dead end road every single time. And that's what the law is. It's going to lead you to the same dead end road when you try to be under it. We don't need to be under the supervision of those instructions anymore, because it's never going to lead us to the ultimate destination of freedom in Christ. Rule following as a means to merit acceptance before God is always a dead end. It's always a dead end. Does that mean we don't need to work at a right behavior? chapters 5 and 6. So just hang on. We'll talk about what living out righteous living looks like in a couple of weeks. So we need that new path. We need to, you know, follow different instructions, and that leads us always to faith in Christ. Verse 26, you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. So that, now this is a radical statement that Paul was making to these Galatian Christians compared to what they were hearing from the Judaizers. They were telling them that the standard for being close to God, and this was the Jewish mindset, is, you know, you might not do it all the way, but the more God accepts you, is the closer you get. Even if you fall short, this is the standard. You just keep working at it, and you're going to be closer to God the longer you work at it. And so he's saying that's not the standard. It's not how good of a rule follower you are. Paul said sonship is not related to the law at all. It comes only through Christ. Verse 27, for all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. Now, he's not talking about water baptism here. He's given that as an illustration. He's talking about spirit baptism into Christ that happens by the Spirit of God the moment you believe. And so what he's saying is that is such a transformational a moment in your life. It's you become completely immersed, just like baptism, going completely under. You are completely immersed in Christ. He goes on to say, and have clothed yourself with Christ. It's kind of two illustrations, being baptized and then clothed. And if you think about first century clothing, what it looked like, cover the head, cover the shoulders, down to the hands, all the way to the feet. So being clothed back then was being completely covered. And he's saying there that his righteousness, Christ's righteousness, the moment you believe, covers you completely. You don't have to work to be more righteous because you have the perfected righteousness of Christ covering you. That's what happens to you. And we'll see later on, he says, now live that way. So verse 28, we're wrapping up. There is neither Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. So he's saying you belong to a completely different system that has freedom at its core. All those things that we used to look to make judgments about, you know, all those external things that we used to look to, that's all gone. You are one, united with every other believer in Christ Jesus. And at that time, there was something that the rabbis would pray every morning that was popular among Jewish people during this time. And it was a prayer that a Jewish man would wake up and thank God that he was not a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. And so Paul picks these three things out on purpose to say, yeah, you're looking at your righteousness as all this external stuff and how much better you are than everybody else. All of that is brought even and level at the foot of the cross. Now, just as application to us, we need to be really careful as believers about how we align ourselves and how we draw lines and we separate from people or we join two people, because our world is full of polarization right now. We are fragmented and splintered and all off into all these little sections that we kind of align ourselves with, either overtly or just kind of drift in that direction, not really realizing it. But it's very easy for us as believers to feel more connected with people who are unbelievers, who agree along certain lines, than it is for us to agree with other believers within the church. We might value a sports team or a political party or an ethnicity or a gender or some other ideology more and align with other unbelievers who are hostile to the faith than we do with other believers who are in the church who don't share our same viewpoints. And what we do in doing that is that we are redrawing lines that Christ died to erase. Okay? Remember that it, you know, yes, we have to be very careful, and there's nothing wrong with liking something or having a connection with somebody who's from the same place you were, or you know, a thing that you enjoy. There's nothing wrong with that. They can actually be excellent ways for you to make conversation with unbelievers to bring them into Christ. You have a common interest. Now you can form a relationship, and now you can bring the gospel with you. Wonderful thing to do, but we have to really be careful to not divide with our sisters and brothers in Christ based on things that are not the gospel, okay? That is wrong. And if he or she is a believer, now you have to be discerning about that, because everybody who says I'm a Christian is not. So you have some discernment about that. But if they are truly believers in Christ, you're on the same team. We are working against the evil forces of darkness together. And we need to be together, because he says we are all one in Christ Jesus. And that's the uniting around believers, uniting around Christ is the most important thing. And you need to let that rise to the top regardless of all these other things that we might want to hold on to. Because the only thing that matters is, are you in Christ? All other differences erased. So he wraps this chapter up with, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And this is just kind of like a statement on the end of this whole section here. He's saying, look, if you're a Christian by faith, everything that was promised is yours. The promise applies to you too. And so here's what I want you to take away from this section. If you're like, wow, I got lost like on the first part. I don't even know all that law and stuff. Here's what I want you to take away from this. And you'll hold on to is this one thing. A pastor I heard said this. There's freedom in facing the hopelessness of your humanity. Now think about that. There's freedom in facing the hopelessness of your humanity. That means your flesh will always fail you. Okay? It will. It will not endure. Your flesh won't. So what he says here is basically, that means it's not up to you. Living the Christian life is not up to you. It's in living and being dependent on the Spirit of God within you to walk this thing out. You can get off the treadmill of trying to earn your way to God's favor. You can't do it. Your flesh is not going to be acceptable to him ever. And so if you could just look at that effort that you are exerting, trying to get God to like you and to approve of you, and realize it is futility. It is futility. Our righteousness is filthy rags to him. We cannot do anything in our own strength that is acceptable. It is hopeless. Your flesh will fail every single time. But, it's a really big but. It's a really good but. If you are a believer, you already have faith. God, as much favor as you ever, on your worst day, on your best day, you have the faith. God. The standard to get God's favor has been met for you. Your flesh doesn't do it. It's Christ and what he did on behalf of us that brings us the favor of God. You have the promise. It's not up to you. It never was. That is the joyful message of Galatians chapter 3. You are baptized into Christ through faith, immersed in him, clothed with him. You have everything you need. You don't have to work for it. It was given to you as a gift by Christ. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
God, we just thank you for the letter to the Galatians, and we are so grateful that we don't have to try to work for your favor. That you so generously provided everything we need, everything we could hope for, everything we could desire, and yet gave it to us as a gift in Christ. God, I just thank you for that. We just stand humbled before you. We are so grateful. God, speak to us. Remind us of the freedom that that you want us to walk in holiness, not as obligation, but as an overwhelming sense of gratitude for what you've done already for us. Thank you for Christ and all he does, and it's in his powerful name we pray. Amen. All right, break to groups.